Thank you very much and welcome to the meeting. And I think all of you are aware of the issues that is at hand with us. One of the main issues that we're having now is about false coddling moth. And this is what we're going to be discussing this afternoon in details. And I'm happy that the EU auditors are here. They will give us an insight exactly on the change. So there have been a change in the regulation in the EU, and for a long time we actually had the issue of false coddling moth in capsicum. We have had a number of interceptions, but according to the information that we have received, this particular pest has become, I think I'll call it notifiable or a quarantine pest in the EU, and therefore it's going to affect our rose production. Mainly it affects the capsicum directly, but now that is a quarantine pest, then any other crop that is affected, again, then it will be affected. It will actually be, we'll have to be able to make sure that all the crops are sent that are zero tolerance, there's zero tolerance to this particular pest. And I think our team will be able to explain that. You know that as an industry, our mandate, that actually our issue is to make sure that we meet the market requirements. And this afternoon we are here to be able to discuss how we as a team are going to move forward to ensure that we are able to control and ensure that the produce we send to Europe are free from false coddling moth. I know we have had an issue, a challenge also with our exports to Australia, and I know we are working on that. So these are two things that I would like all of us to know and be able to work together. And therefore, I want to welcome you. This is your meeting. I would like us to have a cordial discussion. And if there's any question that you have, we'll ask ourselves, you'll be able to ask. We can actually be able to discuss and see how we can be able to move forward from this particular issue that we have. So once again, I want to welcome you. I expect the managing director will be joining us shortly also, just to show our commitment to ensuring that we meet our market requirement. All of you remember when we had a challenge with the Heligobarber. Were you there? I know a number of you remember. Yes, it was a challenge, but I know we worked together and we were able to come out of it. We want to thank the EU that they registered it, but I know it was a real challenge. And therefore, this is what we are gearing ourselves to as we come to the false coddling moth. But we'll see how we are able to work out of this. So therefore, this particular meeting is basically an information and therefore exchange of ideas on how we move on. This particular regulation takes effect from 1st of January. And therefore, we are talking of a very short time, less than, at least I would say just exactly 1 month. We need to have seen what we'll be able to put across and then we can be able to move. So I'll take this time to welcome Jane Gigi to give us some remarks. And then after that, we'll have some quick introduction about the false coddling moth. And then I'll welcome our team from the EU to be able to tell us what are these revisions that we're talking about before we welcome Sylvia Mamis to give us a further presentation. Thank you.
We have worked very well and very cohesively in terms of addressing the challenges, such as Dr. has mentioned with the Heligobarber. And I have no doubt in my mind that even as we begin this, working on this one, we really should be able to surmount any of the challenges that come along our way. I draw strength from the fact that about 2005, the industry was subjected to about 100% inspections in the marketplace, particularly in Europe. And joining forces, myself and Sylvie over here, we were able to put up a very strong lobby group to bring that interception down to the current 5%. And you as an industry has also worked tirelessly, cohesively, to ensure that we have a very positive image in the marketplace as producers of quality assured flowers. I think we have moved on from trying to grow responsibly we are now talking about being quality assured producers of flowers. And so basically what we're saying is that we are not just interested in the flower business alone, we are also interested in the ability of Kenya to remain as a preferred source of fresh produce. We are interested in Kenya remaining a preferred source of quality produce in all aspects, because that way, then we can be quite confident in terms of securing our market share, not just in Europe, but in all the other destinations. And as I've said to a lot of you, we are now the number one producer exporting into the EU, number one with about 40% of that market share. We are number one, I learned recently, of roses going into Australia and also into Japan. So you're on a winning path. And I want to imagine that as you begin to explore the American market, which is going to be stringent, we don't at the moment have any issues, but I'm sure that it will be a stringent market to work with. I'm sure that the systems that we have put in place will be very useful for us as we go down that untrodden path. And I just urge you to continue working as we are, because that is where we draw our strength from. And you have supported the Kenya Flower Council, you have supported me and my chairman, and for that I really want to thank you, and to thank KEFIS also for standing by us on what has been a very rewarding journey. So thank you very much, and Dr. Ray.
International phytosanitary requirements. There are two other options which might be feasible for the country, for Kenya. And that provides a good opportunity for continuing the export of chilies to the European Union. And one is that the KEFIS must certify that the place of production is free from this pest. And during our audit, we had a very detailed discussion with KEFIS experts about the possibilities how to certify this. And we agreed that some additional discussions, internal discussions, are required to elaborate some specific rules and requirements which must be fulfilled before a place of production is certified for free of this false cutting mud. Well, I don't want to say anything before these discussions are completed, but in general I can say that it seems quite feasible to fulfill the conditions in the case if the production takes place under protected environment, I mean in protected greenhouses. It seems to be more difficult to fulfill in these conditions in the case of open air chili production. The fourth option is a specific one. Basically, the legislation requires a cold treatment. It is a common practice for citrus and pomegranate fruit, which is harvested and transferred on a long way on the sea from the African continent to Europe. And during the post-harvest storage, or during the way on the ship from Africa to Europe, there is a good possibility to apply a cold treatment, which means 1 degree centigrade for 3 weeks, which is proven that it is effective for killing any kind of stages of the false cutting mud inside of the fruit. Of course, we know that theoretically this cold treatment can be applied for chilies, but we know that the trade pattern is totally different. Chilies are exported as a fresh product and shipped by air, and the long cold treatment might deteriorate the quality of the fruits. And therefore, the legislation allows, as an alternative, an efficient alternative treatment of the fruit. The text is quite open and general. The treatment can be decided by the National Plant Protection Organization after discussion with the interested stakeholders, or after discussion with the scientists who can be involved in this procedure. Of course, the discussion should start, and CAFIS is aware of all the requirements, and I hope that they will arrange a set of discussions about the possible treatments, about this possible alternative treatment of the chilies, and that would make possible to export chilies produced in places of production which cannot be certified as free from this pest. That is in general. I have to mention one more specific issue. The European legislation requires, in case of application of the both options, the certified place of production free from tomato dulpia, or the application of the appropriate treatment, a very detailed traceability information. And that is a key point. Of course, CAFIS should work together with the associations and with the organizations and with the cooperatives or the growers to establish an information which enables to identify the smallest units where measures must be introduced in the case of an EU interception, or in the case of a rejection at the Nairobi International Airport. Please note, if the export is based on the certification of the freedom of the place of production, you with any kind of interception, the place of production will lose its free status immediately. And it can only be re-established after there is a proof that the pest is eliminated. And the measures have to be applied. Okay? And the closer you can identify the origin of the chilies, the better you can target the measures. Okay?
Then rejection of consignments found with the pest. There's a note that will explain when I will show you some numbers that show actually the already some numbers on interceptions in the EU for capsicum, which might come as a question to some of you, since FCM is not yet regulated, it's not yet fully reported through the Eurofit system. Nevertheless, we see some numbers about capsicum interception. So, and this is due to the fact that capsicum being highest with high risk for FCM, for the last couple of years there has been already surveillance on capsicum and monitoring done in the member states of the, so that's why you will see some numbers on interceptions. Yeah, this again, you've seen it before. I think what is important to understand about FCM is the wide range of host plants. It's estimated about that about 80 species can be contaminated, and most of these species are of high socioeconomic importance in the EU and also in exporting countries. So I think that was also one more reason why measures are being introduced in a very strict way is because of the potential damage that can that could be done in Europe on a wide range of host plants. Yeah, this again, you've just seen. I didn't know whether you would have had this information, but. What I wanted to say is this more specific information have been given by the Dutch phytosanitary authorities, and they actually told me to distribute to everyone today, make sure that everyone gets this information. So I think we will secure circulation to everyone here. So you have all the technical information coming from the Netherlands, which hopefully can help you also in the management of the FCM. Yes. Next one. So again, a summary of what the new regulation actually contains. It's been explained at length by the previous speaker, so I will not go into the details, but most important is that it's so FCM becomes a quarantine pest on all products, so including roses as well. There are indeed some additional requirements for certain fruit and vegetables coming in particular from Africa and Israel. So the different options have been explained, so I'm not going to go through this again. But what is important is that whichever of this option is deemed as applicable to contain the risk must absolutely be communicated by CEFIS to the EU before the 1st of January 2018. That's a very important point that I think must be taken up here. It was specified in the notifications that was given to the WTO to inform of these new rules. So the European Commission actually expects now a communication from exporting countries to either declare that they are free from the pest, which we know is not the case here. So a communication to actually explain the kind of methodology and techniques that will be used here. And this must really be done before 1st of January, otherwise there's a risk that the exports will be banned completely. So I think that's something important to take from CEFIS today. As said already, for roses there are no additional requirements, again linked to the more limited risk of introduction, but that doesn't change the main point, which is it must not be found at the EU borders on roses coming from Kenya. Next one. So, Maybe I can you go back to the, sorry, the before?
Yes, Elijah, this is certainly something that we shall discuss at both the HTA but also the National Task Force, which actually we have a meeting slated for next week. It will certainly be one of the questions, and because PCPB will be part of that sitting, we will raise it and see what it takes to get the product into the country and as fast as possible to yourselves to try if there is enough data on its registration here. Okay?
Yeah, thank you. I think that is very, very important. As you realize, we are looking for any measures that can help us reduce what type of population we are saying. We are saying we know the population is there. Anything that can help us reduce the population, I think that would be highly welcome. And I think we'll be keen in facilitating that. We'll be happy if you have information or we can look for information. I think that will help us in fast-tracking the registration.
I was hoping the inspectors would all leave, so I'm not under scrutiny on whatever I'm saying, but she's staying. Anyway, good afternoon. So, just a quick word about who I am, so you understand also where I'm coming from. So, I'm the Secretary General of Union Fleur. This is the International Flower Trade Association in which we gather all the main countries involved in the trade of cut flowers and plants. So we have a worldwide membership, both in the destination markets with importers and traders, but also in the supplying markets like Kenya. So Kenya Flower Council is one of our very important members, and we've been working together very hard on many market access issues. Because obviously Kenya is the main supplier to the European market, so it is a very important partner in the international trade, in particular for the European traders. The organization is based in Brussels, that's where I work, which gives us also a good place to be close to the European regulators and have with them a direct dialogue on any issue that can actually affect the supply chain of cut flowers and trade. So we look at basically market access conditions, how to facilitate avoid disruption on the supply chain so you can continue exporting your flowers easily to your markets. So most of my work is on regulatory issues and what we call in general the enabling environment for your businesses. So just to give you an overview of our reach and the number of countries that we have in the organization. We have 20 countries in total, and we estimate that we represent about 80% of the worldwide trade in flowers and plants. Sorry. Now coming into, so I was asked to talk about the specific issue of FCM. Well, given my background, I will focus on the impact on the flower business and a bit less on capsicum. But that's why I'm glad it's been explained in details by the inspector. So I think you have a good picture of what's coming up. Actually, there are some slides where you will see this crown. This is the Kingdom of the Netherlands. Just to explain that actually I've prepared the information for today together with the help of the Dutch phytosanitary authorities. And that's actually also part of my message and part of why I'm here today was also to let you know that on the destination side in Europe, the operators flowers, as far as I know, but I'm sure also in French fruit and vegetables, are actually quite anxious about the introduction of these new measures.
So we've had a number of meetings in Europe to discuss the matter and actually try to assess the preparation on both sides. Yesterday, just before I took my flight, I attended a meeting with at the Dutch flower auctions with most of the most important importers and handlers of roses from Kenya there, and the Dutch phytosanitary authorities there to discuss the...
First of January. So I'm also here a little bit as a messenger from your clients in Europe that this issue must really be taken very, very seriously. Also to communicate a sense of urgency to the industry here, because we are 1 month away from the introduction of this new rules. So really, we would like to encourage everyone to really put every effort in making sure that from January things will be under control, because I will explain later on, but the repercussion of this issue could be actually much larger than simply the FCM intervention. So I will explain that. But so this first, I don't think I will go too much into the details of the regulation itself, because a lot has been said already. I just thought it was interesting coming from the Dutch that they actually have had some experience with FCM many years ago. Back in 2004, that's when in 2009, that's where there was a ban enforced by the US on papers coming from the Netherlands because of FCM interception. And then it was again allowed after it was proven that the conditions were met and that the supply chain was safe. But basically, yeah, it's interesting to see that, you know, it is not just an issue that you have to deal with here. It's something that is known also in other countries. And as always, the importance is to comply with the market requirements. Otherwise, you get banned for this kind of issues. What I was mentioning before, what actually make it become now a EU regulation is a pest risk assessment that was carried out in 2011 and 12 by EPO. EPO is the regional phytosanitary organization for Europe and Mediterranean countries. So they carried out a specific risk assessment for FCM, and the conclusion of this risk assessment was that it was highly recommended to regulate and introduce some management measures for FCM in some specific commodities, which are capsicum and citrus, as far as I remember. In this report, it was said specifically that roses are not indeed not a major pathway for different reasons. In particular, because of the way roses are transported in cold temperature, that actually, as far as I understand, that stops the development of the insect, and also because of the, let's say, the distribution system. When roses get to Europe, they usually don't go near to production places. They go directly either through the auction or through importing companies, but they don't come next to the production places. So the risk of contamination by cut roses is actually quite limited. So the EPO...
Merci. The EPO risk assessment clearly said that roses are not a major pathway. Nevertheless, there was a recommendation to regulate in general for FCM for the European market. So that's how the process was started. So there was a whole process of discussion and assessment and evaluation between 2013 and And this year, this is where, as a as an industry body representing flower countries, we did submit comments on the consultation and actually ask for the regulations to be implemented in a reasonable way, given the socio-economic importance of roses coming from East Africa. But obviously, this is not something that could be stopped, because, as was said before, it is a risk for the European territory. So there was no discussion about even trying to stop the regulation. So I was, as was said before, as from 1st of January 18, false codling moss is will be qualified as quarantine pest in the EU, and that means that it must not be found. It must not be found. If it is found, that will mean destruction, rejection of consignments found with the pest. There's a note that we'll explain when I will show you some numbers that show actually the already some numbers on interceptions in the EU for capsicum, which might come as a question to some of you, since FCM is not yet regulated, it's not yet fully reported through the Eurofit system. Nevertheless, we see some numbers about capsicum interception. So, and this is due to the fact that capsicum being highest, with high risk for FCM, for the last couple of years there has been already surveillance on capsicum and monitoring done in the member states of the. So that's why you will see some numbers on interceptions. Yeah, this again, you've seen it before. I think what is important to understand about FCM is the wide range of host plants. It's estimated about that about 80 species can be contaminated, and most of these species are of high socio-economic importance in the EU and also in exporting countries. So I think that was also one more reason why measures are being introduced in a very strict way, is because of the potential damage that can that could be done in Europe on a wide range of host plants. Yeah, this again, you've just seen. I didn't know whether you would have had this information, but what I wanted to say is this more specific information have been given by the Dutch phytosanitary authorities, and they actually told me to distribute to everyone today, make sure that everyone gets this information. So I think we will secure circulation to everyone here. So you have all the technical information coming from the Netherlands, which hopefully can help you also in the management of the FCM. Yes. Next one. So again, a summary of what the new regulation actually contains. It's been explained at length by the previous speaker, so I will not go into the details, but most important is that it's so FCM becomes a quarantine pest on all products, so including roses as well. There are indeed some additional requirements for certain fruit and vegetables coming in particular from Africa and Israel. So the different options have been explained, so I'm not going to go through this again. But what is important is that whichever of this option is deemed as applicable to contain the risk must absolutely be communicated by CEFIS to the EU before the 1st of January 2018. That's a very important point that I think must be taken up here. It was specified in the notifications that was given to the WTO to inform of these new rules. So the European Commission actually expects now a communication from exporting countries to either declare that they are free from the pest, which we know is not the case here. So a communication to actually explain the kind of methodology and techniques that will be used here. And this must really be done before 1st of January, otherwise there's a risk that the exports will be banned completely. So I think that's something important to take from KFIS today. As said already, for roses there are no additional requirements against linked to the more limited risk of introduction, but that doesn't change the main point, which is it must not be found at the EU borders on roses coming from Kenya. Next one. So, Maybe I can you go back to the before? Just to comment on this, in the meeting that I attended yesterday in the Netherlands, that's a question that came up actually. There was a question whether IPM tools were available to control the pest, because you know there's also a keen interest in this kind of instruments rather than chemicals, etc. So I'm sure that you know there will be also a lot of support from the end of the chain to actually make this IPM tools available.